We're now on Radio 4. Here's Victoria Coren-Mitchell with the new series of the programme that likes to commit heresy.
Hello and welcome to Heresy, the show that challenges received wisdom and sends lazy thinking on a Club 1830 holiday to Iron Napa. With me in the waiting room of the STD clinic to give lazy thinking the bad news are comedian Alex Horne, cutting-edge drag artist Jonny Wu, and the TV producer and presenter Richard Osman. We'll be taking three statements of commonly held opinion and trying to argue against them. Later in the show, they'll be about giant lottery wins and sizzling TV dramas. But first...
Who cares what they're wearing on Main Street or Savile Row? It's what you wear from ear to ear, and not from head to toe, that matters.
Hey, hobo man, hey, Dapper Dan, you both got your smile, but brother, you're never fully dressed without a smile.
Never fully dressed without a smile, or some people would say, trousers. Certainly, 62% of our audience in the theatre tonight believe you should not do the school run in your pyjamas. This is something parents do to save time, of course, and there's a definite advantage to wearing pyjamas or a onesie when driving children to school, as it means you won't stain your smarter clothes if you spill your can of cider. Richard Osman, is it inexcusable to do the school run in pyjamas?
I think it's inexcusable to never have done the school run in your pyjamas. It's crazy. You know what? My kids are older now. They get themselves to school, which is well, I assume that's what they're doing. certainly, they're not in the house. If you have kids of school age, you have to take them to school 195 times a year. You've probably got to do that from 2 to 11, something like that. That's 1,800 times you take your kids to school. If you could do 1,800 times without ever once being late, then you are a monster. If you sleep naked, by all means, put some clothes on. If you are wearing a gimp suit, then set the alarm 20 minutes early. But otherwise, do you know what? Go to school in your slippers, pyjamas, whatever you're wearing.
Alex Horne, what do you think?
I think you should do your school run in pyjamas. I think you must. I think it's the whole point is that you're the grown-up now. And the whole point of not being a child anymore is you can do whatever you want. And it's a sort of basic human right. You can wear what you want. It's like having fresh water or education or Wi-Fi or snacks. They can't take it away from us. Like, I think you should wear whatever you want. I think you're setting a good example, not a bad one.
Jonny Wu, what do you think of parents who take their kids to school in pyjamas?
Well, when you gave me this one, I kind of like, the wearing the pyjamas kind of wasn't the thing. It was the notion of the school run. It's like, where the hell are we? You know, when I grew up, the kids walked to school or got a bus to school. Why? You know, it's true. Why? What is this doing the school run? What is this doing the school run? So I think it's basically a protest by the middle classes, and it's going to be predominantly middle-class women, because I'm sure there aren't many pictures of men taking the kids to the school in their pyjamas. I'm sure it's a woman in some kind of wincey onesie or something. And I think it's a feminist protest, being pinned down to having to take their demanding kids to school on a daily basis. I think it's a new post-punk feminism.
This was inspired by a news story recently. Kate Chisholm, the head teacher at Skern Park Academy in Darlington, wrote to the parents to tell them stop bringing children to school in pyjamas.
I have to say, I think pyjamas are getting quite a bad press out of all this, because I wear quite casual clothes normally. I would say my pyjama suit is the smartest outfit I wear, because it's matching, it's checkered, it's got a collar, and I would argue... It's an outdoor option. It's got pockets, which you don't need. I mean, I do sometimes sleep with my hands in my pockets because it's a relaxed posture. But I'd say the breast pocket is only for out. That's for your car keys.
90% of people don't actually sleep in their pyjamas. So I'd actually prefer to see people just jumping out of bed and just getting in the car wearing exactly what they went to bed in. Now, that would be a statement.
Just a satisfied grin.
Yes.
I definitely find the best way to be fully dressed in the morning is to just go to sleep on the sofa at 4 a.m. But just for a bit of context on our views, Jonny, talk us through what you're wearing this evening.
Oh. I'm wearing kind of like a see-through bespoke caftan that a dear friend of mine, Jackie Potato, made for me. With a bit of a kind of a little bit inspired by Margot from The Good Life. I've got a bit of a, you know, kind of suburban flick going on in the hair.
Alex, talk us through your outfit.
Well, it's similar. It's again see-through, and it leaves little to the imagination.
Thing is, when I'm in the car in rush hour traffic in the morning, I don't want to be distracted worrying about what I'm wearing. I want to be concentrating on what I'm doing, texting. But I very much like your argument, Jonny, about this post-punk feminism, because I do... I mean, my child's very small, not going to school at the moment, but you hear about competition at the school gates and everyone judging each other for what they're wearing. That is a competition I don't want to be in.
Who can look the worst?
But also, you know, the worst thing about school gates is not what people are wearing. It's the fact that there is always a group of parents, mothers and fathers, who know what's happening that day, and you don't know how they worked it out. And you turn up and they go, oh, well, you know that the teaching assistant in Year 7 is leaving to go to Tibet, so all the children are wearing orange hats. Did you not... and you go, like, because you know when they talk about the dark web, that web that... That's what's going on the dark web. It's those five parents at that school going, oh, it's...
What about dress codes in general, the expectation to wear certain things? What do you think of black tie? What about you, Jonny? If you see black tie or some kind of dress code on the invitation, do you naturally follow it or go for something different?
Well, if I'm generally invited to, like, a posh do, it's because they want me to do a look. So I get all the joys that women have in kind of choosing, like, a fabulous gown or something. So I feel sorry for men who have to wear kind of a black tie to a... just to look all the same. And generally, black tie suits are really badly cut. Cummerbunds never make anyone look attractive, especially if they've got a bit of a paunch.
It depends where you wear them. If you wrap them around the head, sometimes it's...
It's funny, you are the exact opposite of my husband, who thinks...
In so many ways.
Not as many as you think.
Yeah, no, you're quite right.
See, my husband thinks, why on earth, when something says black tie, would men choose to wear something different and have all the hell that women go through trying to work out what should you wear, is it the right thing, do I look nice, and thank God for a sort of uniform. What do you think, Alex?
I completely agree with your husband. I think if there was more uniforms, life would be so much easier. I think if everyone turned up at the school gates in pyjamas, I mean, because I'm a comedian, which you shouldn't have to say this late on in the programme, but word got out at the school playground that I was... Another parent found out and they said to me, have I seen you on TV? And I had to say, well, I don't know, because when you're in it, you can't see who's... It's not a it's not a window. So word went round. And then people expect you to be hilarious in everything you do and expect you to turn up in a sort of clown outfit. So if it was just everyone in pyjamas, you're off. I think that's just... Life would be easier.
It also suggests that, you know, people who don't turn up in pyjamas, it's because they've got something to do afterwards, something tiresome, like going to yoga or something like that, or sleeping with their tennis coach. Whereas if you go in your pyjamas, do you know exactly... You're going home to watch Homes Under the Hammer with a Twix, you know? And those are the parents you want to hang out with.
Let's see what the audience think about this. Where is Jane Myers? You think people should not do the school run in their pyjamas. Why not?
I've got three children, and I'm just a sensible person that thinks it sets the wrong example to the children. They could say they want to go to school in pyjamas, and it sort of is a slippery slope.
I'd like to go to school on a slippery slope.
But why shouldn't they go to school in pyjamas? Why does it matter?
Well, they are only six. And, I know it's a bit forward to be thinking about their working life in the future, but I just want them to be, you know, start being sensible adults at six. And but I did like what Jonny said about the post-feminist thing. I think, you know, I've been doing the school run for many, many years and I'm really, really fed up. So actually, maybe wearing pyjamas makes the whole boring thing a little bit more interesting. So I will bear it in mind.
We have a convert. Where is Anne-Marie Higgins? You think people should not do the school run in their pyjamas. Why not?
Well, I don't have any children, but the pyjama thing leads to a bigger problem of the bralessness point. So what do we do about that? I don't know.
I want to hear more about this problem.
I mean, I wear a full bra and corset under everything. And all that. Not a sexy one either, a really sort of constructed metal
thing. Yeah, because I've been to Tesco's without one, but you have to avoid everybody. If you see anyone you know, it's not good.
So. Unexpected item in bagging area.
I think we should wind up that topic. I think we've argued this excellently. The conclusion is we should care a lot less what other people wear, especially in the car. The way I see it, my car is my own private kingdom. I am the queen of my car. So when I'm in it, I do exactly what the queen would do. Get drunk and bet on horses. Next, we're going to talk about the pros and cons of sudden wealth. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Notorious B.I.G. there with his hit Mo Money, Mo Problems. Is that not right?
Yeah, this is right. That was also my nickname at school, Notorious B.I.G.
It's a song about the problems associated with being rich. Ironic, because at the time of its release, Notorious B.I.G.'s main problem was that he'd recently been murdered in a drive-by shooting. Our audience tonight do not share Notorious B.I.G.'s mixed feelings about money. In fact, 88% of them think it would be great to win the Euro Millions lottery. Alex Horne, what do you think?
I disagree with that. I agree with the man in the song, the gentleman singing. I think there would be more problems because, first of all, once you've got this money, I don't know what you would do with your life. You wouldn't have to work anymore. You'd have, I mean, again, yes, you could spend your time with your family, but I don't think so. You know, it's not a decent option. I think the problem with winning that much money is that the rest of your life is rendered meaningless. It would be like doing a murder. Once you've done a murder or won the lottery, that's it. You're the guy who did a murder or won the lottery.
No, if you won murder and that's never enough.
What do you think, Richard? Do you love to win the Euro Millions?
I wouldn't love to win the Euro Millions at all. I would like to win a British lottery, please. I don't want to win. My political views are neither here nor there, but I have no interest in a European lottery. What are you going to spend it on? Oh, the only crisps they have are paprika flavoured. Think of the money they took off you at the Bureau de Change. You could win like 13 million and suddenly you get like £87.50. You think, how did that happen? So Euro Millions not for me, I'm afraid.
But once you win the national lottery, you automatically qualify for the Euro. I think you automatically go through to the Champions League lottery.
What do you think, Jonny? Would you love to win the Euro Millions?
I am one of those people, you know, like, if I'm out for dinner or something, or out for drink, you know, I'm like, okay, I'll get it, I'll buy you dinner or something, I'll buy you a drink. What I'm trying to say, I'm the kind of person who buys friendship. I buy my friends, I've basically got no money and lots of friends, okay? That's basically where I'm at. So with the Euro Millions, I'm basically up to my limit on Facebook and I can't actually buy any more friends as it stands, so I'm going to be totally frustrated. And I'm kind of down with you on this kind of abject misery that it's going to cause, but only because I imagine that winning the millions will make me so happy, being a tortured artist that I am, I'm not going to be able to kind of do any more art, so then I'm going to be desperately miserable.
Genuinely, I think it brings an awful lot of issues, winning all of those millions. I think, you know what, think of the tax you'd have to avoid. Oh, man, can you know what? Genuinely, I like staying at home watching Bake Off. I do not want to be flying to Panama every 15 minutes. You know, I'm not interested in doing it. But also, you have to, then you know what, the thing about rich people is they hang out with other rich people, and other rich people are awful. You know what, it just brings all that awful world of people trying to sell you stuff that you don't need.
What things that you currently do for yourself would you employ people to do for you?
I think everything. I mean, why would you do anything? I would have somebody watching Bargain Hunt for me and then getting actors to act it out so I didn't have to face the television. I'd have Sir Ian McKellen pretending to be John from Barnsley saying, do those cufflinks have some age to them, do you think?
The thing with money, I've also actually got really, really bad taste. So if I had kind of a shed load of money, and I was now responsible for painting and to being the interior decorator of this vast kind of mansion that I would obviously have to buy, it would look absolutely hideous.
You've got £150 million, you've decorated the house, what does it look like?
Well, I tell you what, if not on £150 million, but maybe on £15, when I was kind of like first moved to London, my choice of colours for my walls was aubergine for the ceiling, it was electric blue for the walls facing my bed, and acid yellow going around the window. And then I had a really naff marley blue landlord carpet, and my dad, for some reason, I don't know why, had made me this dressing screen out of this chocolate brown silk paisley fabric that had like a rainbow design going through it.
£15.
Let's go to the audience. Where is Evangeline Boothman? Why would you like to win the Euro Millions?
Because it did give you the freedom to do whatever you wanted in life rather than just, for example, pick a job because you wanted to earn a certain amount of money.
What would you do? I mean, exactly. Exactly.
But listen,
actually,
imagine...
you're right, it's too much choice.
Victoria, when you do win this money, do you have to decide as quick... Do you have someone like you saying, what are you spending it on?
Andrew Atkinson, you would love to win the Euro Millions lottery. Would you tick the no publicity box?
I would, yeah.
And then would you keep it quiet from everyone you know?
I would keep it quiet from everybody. I would just disappear, yeah.
That means... that means he might have already won it.
Return back to my normal life with nobody any the wiser. That I'd just blown 150 million.
How quickly do you think you could blow 150 million?
Quite quickly.
Like in a year, like 6 months?
Yeah. Yeah, why not?
The first purchase?
The first purchase, God.
Exactly. Exactly.
I'll tell you what I would buy. I'd buy Trident. Why not, right? Keep it out of everyone else's hands.
How much does Trident... Do you mean the chewing gum? Because it's more pricey, isn't it, than
Riddles. Yeah, no, I buy a whole box, though.
Yeah.
Like the ones that you see through the door at the back of the newsagent, yeah. I buy a whole one.
I think we should wind up this debate. No one can think what they spend the money on apart from Richard who'd buy Trident, which I think proves our point. It would not be great to win the Euro Millions, which is just as well, because we're not going to. Our own national lottery, of course, was launched in 1994 with the slogan, "It could be you," which narrowly beat the other possible slogans, "I can absolutely guarantee it won't be you," and "You probably shouldn't be buying 30 lottery tickets, you're an income support." For our last topic, we're going to talk about bonnets and bonking. The music there from Pride and Prejudice, the classic 1995 TV series where Colin Firth emerged dripping from the family lake. Since then, TV costume dramas have just got filthier and filthier. I don't like it when actors in historical dramas show off their breasts and buttocks, or as I call them, their upstairs, downstairs. 68% of our audience tonight, however, say, "I do love a sizzling, sexy costume drama." Jonny Woo, how do you feel?
I look like the person who should like a sizzling, sexy costume drama, don't I? But I kind of got the hatred for them back in, like, the 80s or something, you know, as a teenager growing up in, like, suburban Kent. And you'd sit there, you know, the day before going to school, and you'd have sat, they all sat in there, kind of like not speaking, watching Songs of Praise, then Anti-Groucho, and then you'd have to sit through an hour of like a dreary costume drama, and all you wanted to see was That's Life. You're just kind of waiting for That's Life and seeing Gavin Campbell in a tub of baked beans or something. And so I've always had like a hatred of them. And then I bought Poldark. You know, the BBC can thank me for this. I bought Poldark and watched 3 episodes. That's about all I could manage. And I kind of find it hilariously funny how this is kind of set in the 18th century, but they always give the costume a slightly modern twist or something. You've got kind of the wench, the serving wench, who is just kind of like shagged in episode 3, if kind of, you know, that's not a spoiler. you know, just shagged in episode, and she goes to bed with this kind of like ginger tousled hair. You know, and she's supposed to be a pauper. She's supposed to be a pauper. She's supposed to be emaciated, dirty, and disgusting. And that's another thing about sex in costume dramas. Remember, they don't wash. They didn't wash back then, so, you know.
I actually found the sex scenes in Pole Dark quite true to life, in that I slept through them. What do you think, Richard, of a sizzling, sexy costume dramas?
Oh, I'm not a big fan of costume dramas because, you know what, it's just some actors, you know? And you know what actors are like, and you know, you just picture them sitting on the bus, you know, when they're having their catering and they're all dressed, they're all delighted to be dressed up in an 18th century thing. They, you know what, I can't bear it. I like to think of now as like a costume drama, as like the olden days. If you look at the world now and think of it nostalgically, it's quite a nice thing. I was in Sainsbury's yesterday and they don't have contactless in Sainsbury's. You have to use a chip and pin, like it's Tudor London. And I was putting my thing, I was having to physically put the numbers in, and I thought, I'm like in a costume, all I need is Aidan Turner. Aidan Turner with his top off and a scythe, and this would be a Sunday night drama. So I think now is a time of nostalgia.
Andrew Davis, the well-known TV writer, said about the sex scenes in his adaptation of Tolstoy's War and Peace, very sexy. He said, it was all there. He just hadn't written the scenes. So it wasn't there. I mean, it wasn't there. What do you think, Alex, of sizzling costume dramas?
I mean, I have a problem with the word sizzling. My favourite words in the show so far have been wench, toozled and bralessness. But I agree with both these fine men, because it is pathetic, I think, watching these people pretending. They're just pretending, and it is inauthentic, because they try to make it realistic in some way. You know, you have the right clothes, the right length nose and all that sort of thing, but they're still filming it with these HD cameras. I would prefer it if they just did the acting, the pretending, in a field somewhere with no one filming, one person watching, and then that person tells somebody else what happened. They tell 10 more people, and then the final person tells me, and that's authentic. That's how I want to have my costume dramas. I like Jaws, the film. Yes. Jaws.
When I was younger, I think when I was a teenager, I quite liked there to be sex in things. This was pre-internet. You might see, ooh, that's sort of a bit of someone a bit nude. I thought it was quite sexy. The older I get, the more embarrassing I find it. I can't bear it. As you say, they are just actors. They've gone to work and now they're taking their clothes off and they're a bit topless and they're rubbing each other. Yuck. And it's so embarrassing.
But did you like it when you were watching like the costume drama with your family and there was kind of like a sex scene going on? Were you kind of like secretly enjoying yourself?
Well, it wasn't better for the presence of my family. But when I didn't really know what sex was, you know, it's a bit exciting. I mean, they're not like that now, teenagers, because they've got the internet, so they sort of know everything. But I found it all a bit exciting. But now I just can't... I don't need there to be, you know, my parents there. I'm embarrassed for the actors that they had to do this.
Is it meant to be more sexy and sizzling because it was in the part? Because, you know, people rarely wear bonnets when they go clubbing, you know, is a way to attract the opposite sex. I don't understand.
I think what it is, it's to give it a sort of spurious cultural finesse.
Mm. We know how this ends, and that is you all died 250 years ago.
Did you see The Night Manager? I thought that was a great series. Everyone talked about Tom Hiddleston. You could see his bottom in one scene. Normally it's the women have to show everything, but their trousers were down, the bottom was out. You know, it's not like I wasn't pleased to see it, but I just thought about him that morning, thinking, oh, it's bum day.
No, but it's, you know what? Because he's an actor, they'll be talking about the importance of, you know, just he'll justify it in some way. They'll be on the bus going, really, really, it's interesting, a really exposing scene I'm going to do, but very important in terms of the way that we realign gender stereotypes on television drama.
He'd have done a lot of work on that bum as well, I can tell you.
Oh, I think you would have done, wouldn't you?
That's obscene.
So Alex too.
I think he should have done every scene with his little bottom out. I think that would have made the whole thing much more enjoyable.
I think that is the reason they put the sex in costume dramas. I think they put the sex in costume dramas because it's set in the 18th century, or maybe it's a famous novel. So because it was very intellectual, I mean, it's an excuse to see people sort of getting it on, and I just don't want to see. Is it just me?
You're the costume dramas you're talking about, I assume, are the Sunday evening kind of 7 o'clock ones, aren't they? They're not like your big Hollywood blockbusters. These are kind of designed for frustrated, sexually barren kind of like marriages, basically, aren't they? What?
It's for people
watching it together, so they can kind of think they're getting off on the mining crisis in Cornwall in the kind of like the 1780s or something, where actually they're kind of really getting off on Flopsy or Ross or what have you.
And it's also it's,
showing
it's,
a little bit of.
And it's Sunday night, and they were disappointed that Country Fire wasn't what they thought it was going to be.
Rob Burrows, you've said you do love a sizzling, sexy costume drama. What is it you enjoy about them?
Well, to be honest, I do and I don't. I've got six sisters, and they love costume dramas, and I was brought up having to sit through Pride and Prejudice. And it's, to me, it's a series where absolutely nothing happens. I mean, do they, don't they? Eventually they do, but they could do it in 10 minutes, the whole show. And if it wasn't for the cleavage, I could never have survived.
I like the idea that Pride and Prejudice is like Deal or No Deal. Let's just get it done.
I mean, you could say that about anything, couldn't you? You could say that about a murder. Someone was murdered. It was the cousin.
True.
Pride and Prejudice kicked things off, in my view, because everyone talked about the Colin Firth scene, but he was just wearing a wet shirt. This day and age, I mean, Downton Abbey, don't many people remember this, Downton Abbey began with Lady Mary humping a Turk to death. That's quite an odd beginning for a story about a country house. Lucy MacDonald,
yes.
Why do you love a sizzling, sexy costume
well,
drama?
Well, I'm not actually very sure. I was just thinking about this. When I replied to that, I was just thinking, I probably do quite like them, but I'm not sure that we've actually watched any. But I think the concept of the drama and everything is rather lovely, the fact that it is all rather glamorous and fabulous, and actually I think it isn't, is it? It is already rather dirty.
I like it that no one's actually seen any of these. I was feeling really bad, but oh no, I haven't watched them, but you know, I'm with the people, nobody knows what the hell you're talking about.
Nobody will admit to watching them. It's like real pornography, isn't it?
That's it.
What if, Alex, what if you were offered a leading role?
That's such
in a major
big if.
Costume drama? There's a lot of money, major exposure. The bottom has to come out.
Exposure of you, exactly.
I mean, how much money? Because, you know, if it's 150 million, that would make my life awful. We know that. I mean, I'd do it. Anything, really, to get out of the house.
I think this is an excellent place to bring the programme to an end. I'm going to leave you with a plea for no more explicit sex in TV costume dramas. It's awkward and hammy, and it can go very wrong. The BBC were admonished for their adaptation of Martin Chuzzlewit, in which they inadvertently showed viewers a complete penis. It was Keith Allen appearing as Jonas Chuzzlewit. Thank you very much to my brilliant guests, Alex Horne, Jonny Wu, and Richard Osman. Thanks to the audience for taking part. Thank you for listening. Good night.
Heresy is written, presented and produced by Victoria Coren-Mitchell and co-produced by Daisy Knight, with additional material by Charlie Skelton and Colin Swash. The series was created by David Baddiel and is an Avalon production for BBC Radio 4.